Yo, what's going on, St. George, Utah, or wherever you are tuning in to the Jacob Zimmerman Show here on 91.3 The Blaze. Glad you are joining me. Gonna talk some great topics today. Let's go ahead and get into that rundown in just a sec. But first, let's talk about what we talked about last week. First, we started it off with the Thursday Night Football segment. We watched the Browns. We watched the Broncos in that one. After I introduced a little game called Yes or BS, doing all NBA edition once again today. Possibly we might have James Guerin stopping by to help us out with that, but that was a really fun one we did with James and Price last week, and we are going to do it again. Then after that, or before that actually, got a huge interview, another Dixie State football player coming on the show. Max Christensen will be joining us here very shortly. After that, we'll have the Week 8 spread picks in the NFL, and we will possibly look at the Dixie State volleyball game going on right now, depending on the status of that. But I always like to start off my show talking about some Thursday night football. It goes on during my show. I like that. I do it for a reason, and I always start off the show talking about some Thursday night football. The Cardinals have the lead 7-0 with less than a minute to go here in the first quarter. The Packers currently with the ball in the red zone into territory of the Cardinals, and they are down to about the 12-yard line currently as I speak. A few moments ago, I was watching the stream. DeAndre Hopkins had a big touchdown pass called back. Now, why was it called back? They first maybe thought he stepped out of bounds, pass interference, something like that. Nope, it was after the grab. He was running towards the end zone. He was actually stiff-arming a Packer defender behind him. But when he did have the stiff arm on the face mask of the Packers defender, he did grab the face mask. Therefore, it was a penalty. Didn't matter. The Cardinals punched it in, and since then, the Packers hadn't scored. Right now, the chains are out on the field, and there is a measurement going on. And it looks like it is going to be short. That's going to set up a 4th-and-1. But just a quick reminder, here in a couple minutes, we're going to have Max Christensen on the show. Dixie State football, he's on the defensive line, and I can't wait to do that interview. But here for next couple minutes, talking some Thursday night football between the Packers and Cardinals. And you know, in this one, both teams got Super Bowl aspirations. The Packers haven't lost since week one. The Cardinals haven't lost all year, and both of them have been looking really good at the top of the NFC. Randall Cobb's going to have to be huge because Devontae Adams is not in the game. And Aaron Rodgers growing out that hair from last season. You can see it poking out the back of his helmet as they got a 4th-and-1 deep into Cardinals territory here in just any moment. I'd like to bring you guys some Thursday night football talk because I know you're driving around in your car right now and you cannot check the score unless you pull over. So that's why I'm doing this. That's why I'm here. Aaron Rodgers is in the shotgun. He's got two receivers, a tight end to the top of the screen, and a big first quarter possession won't even happen. Looks like the first quarter is done. But with this one, J.J. Watt out for the year, Chandler Jones coming back. They kind of cancel each other out. And Kyler Murray, they set a stat before I got started with the show on the broadcast that I thought I wanted to mention. Kyler Murray has the least amount of hits since he came into the league among quarterbacks. That's a really fascinating stat. A lot of people thought he was just going to get crushed and killed, but those quick feet get him away from those tackles. The game took the break. I will take the break. Here, when we come back, we will have the Max Christensen interview for you guys. Stay tuned for that. Don't touch that dial.
Just sending a gift to Dave 2037? Who?
Me in the future. I save a little money from every paycheck for Dave 2037 so he can buy anti-gravity boots or a hologram Doberman. What are you getting Steve 2037?
Steve 2037 will be just fine.
Well, okay, but don't expect to borrow my anti-gravity boots.
Save something for the future. Put away a few bucks, feel like a million bucks. For free ways to save, go to feedthepig.org. That's
feedthepig.org.
This message brought to you by the American Institute of Certified Public Accountants and the Ad Council.
I'm the only one in school that can tie his own shoes.
Most kids make fun of me because I still believe in the tooth fairy.
A third of the kids in my 8th grade class drink alcohol regularly.
Over 99% of my class has been offered illegal drugs.
Half of my college classmates binge drink, abuse drugs, or do both. But the frequent dinners I had with my family have helped make sure I'm not one of them.
Learn more about the National Center on Addiction and Substance Abuse at Columbia University's Family Day at CasaFamilyDay.org. Dinner makes a difference.
I lost my vision 5 years ago. Thought I'd never read again.
Then she discovered Talking Books, a free program through the Library of Congress's National Library Service for the blind and physically handicapped.
Keeping me connected to my world? Now you're talking.
This year, the Talking Book and Braille program celebrates 80 years of delivering books and magazines right to the doorsteps of those unable to read, from children to seniors and veterans.
Letting me read what all my friends are reading, too. Now you're talking.
To learn more, call 1-888-NLS. Read.
There are those who dedicate themselves to a sense of honor, to a life of courage, and a commitment to something greater than themselves. They have always defended this nation and each other. They still do. The few, the proud.
Thanks for asking, but I'd rather not send you nude pictures. I'm camera shy. I already said no. Under my clothes, I'm a robot. My webcam is broken. I'm worried they'll get passed around school. I have a rash. I have nudophobia. I have lizard skin. I'm a vampire, so I don't show up in pictures anyways. Your badgering has really killed the mood.
When someone is pressuring you to do something you don't want to, how many ways can you say no before they get the message? Let us know at thatsnotcool.com. Brought to you by the Ad Council.
Oh! You are round MVP.
Yeah, man! Yo, Drew, I finally got round MVP. Round MVP.
No way! That was some ownage.
Finally earning round MVP takes determination. So will getting into college. I've got what it takes. So do you.
Visit knowhowtogo.org to learn what you should be doing right now to prepare for college. Start taking the steps at knowhowtogo.org. Brought to you by the American Council on Education, Lumina Foundation, and the Ad Council.
Welcome back to the Jacob Zimmerman Show on 91.3 The Blaze. Right back to it, the Jacob Zimmerman Show here on 91.3. What's going on? Hope you're having a good Thursday evening. Now, I like to try to do interviews on this show every single week. Last week, I had John Judkins. Now, I didn't get him in here. I had to go on down to the Burns Arena and get that interview with Coach. But this week, I got another Dixie State football player on my show. Not just any football player. He's one of the biggest guys on the team, folks. Max Christensen III. What's going on, my man? How are you doing?
Good, my man. Thank you for having me. I appreciate this.
No problem. So I got word from you that you had helmets only practice earlier today. How'd that go?
It went good. Just, you know, this Thursday practice, we say it's the most important practice of the week. It's where, you know, we take the pads off, we take the hitting off, and we really sharpen our technique and our tools and just the game plan that we're going to have going into Saturday.
So we're going to talk a lot about Dixie State football here, but a bit of questions about you. You started your career not here at Dixie State, but up at Snow College. You had two sacks your freshman year there. What was kind of the reason for coming down to Dixie?
You know, I just felt like this was a really good fit for me, not only from a football standpoint, but from a academic standpoint as well. You know, I really take academics seriously. You know, I'm not just in college to play football, put on the jersey and do that, but I know that school and a degree and just the experience that I can get from Dixie State is something that can really help me after football as well, because I know that at some point it's going to end, whether it's here at Dixie State. You know, everybody wants a shot to play in the league, in the NFL, but if I don't get there, I know I need something to fall back on, so academics is big for me. So, and also just you know, I knew I wanted to be a part of this transition, transitioning in from Division II to Division I, you know, this being my first semester here at Dixie State, coming from Snow College, and so I knew this is something I wanted to be a part of.
I had Keith Davis on the show a couple weeks back, your teammate. He also had a transfer and came to Dixie State. I'm glad both of you guys ended up coming to St. George. But last week, you guys had the homecoming game. You took on Stephen F. Austin. The second half, looking at the box score, pretty solid, but in that second quarter, they kind of really took things away. What was your takeaway from that game?
You know, it's kind of in the same story for us every week, where we play a really good two quarters. Every single game this year, we've played a really, really good two quarters against really, really good teams. Now we just need to put together a good game. You know, it was our strength coaches this last week, Craig Timmons. He told us, hey, you know, we have a bunch of really, really good players, but we don't have a really good team right now. So we got to find a way to put all the pieces in place so we can have a good team. So, yeah, like we have really, really good and solid stretches throughout the game, which is actually really frustrating, because we've shown that we can play with these guys. We've shown that we can play with and hang with some of the top teams in FCS college football. But we have to be able to put together a good four-quarter game.
And I've seen those. I call the games every weekend here on 91.3 doing the play-by-play. And, yeah, I would totally agree with you. It looks like for a couple quarters, a couple moments of the game, you guys can hang with anybody. And then a couple possessions later, you turn right around and it looks like the opposite. So that must be frustrating to watch. But the game plan going into Delaware this weekend is what? What kind of specific adjustments have the coaches been making?
So, you know, being a defensive tackle, being a defensive lineman, I know I can only really speak from the defensive side of the ball. But for us, it's all going to come down to stopping the run. You know, they have a really, really good, really, really good, very, very big offensive line. You know, their left tackle, he's had a lot of experience. He's started over 30 games, been a part of 40-plus games there at Delaware. He's an All-American. He knows what he's doing. A lot of the guys up front have experience. And, again, they're just massive. And so, you know, they suffered a loss to their starting quarterback a couple weeks ago. And so we know what they want to do is they want to run the ball. Their running back is really good. You know, I mean, their running back's only 5'7", and their shortest offensive lineman is 6'4". And so they really want to be able to hide him behind that offensive line, have him duck through holes and run for a lot of yards. And so we feel like if we can stop the run, if we can put the ball into their backup quarterback's hands, you know, it's anybody's game. But again, in every single football game, as you know, it's about stopping the run first, getting them to put the ball in the air, and then going from there.
I want to quickly mention one of your teammates from last week who had a career day, and I'm sure you had a really fun time as well as all your other teammates watching him pop off for 183 rushing yards. What did you think of Drew Cannelli-Robles going out there going ham?
Yeah, no, Drew does a great job for us week in and week out. He's done that since the start of the year. Our offensive line played very well last week. Also, being able to move guys out of the way, being able to climb to that second level and kind of doing what they do. And so I feel like progressively over the year, we've all been able to get better at every position. But last week especially, Drew was able to do some special things for us. And that's what we expect from him as one of our top players.
Last week, I remember calling your name. On the broadcast, and I thought it was a tackle for loss. The box score does not agree with me, and you had two tackles in that game officially. Kind of take me through those two tackles that you had.
You know, it's really about the other 10 guys around me. That's who, you know, we all play for each other. We're all playing for not only each other, but for Dixie State as a whole. And so, you know, those tackles, any stats that I have, anything that happens throughout the game goes to the other guys around me. You know, I mean, as a defensive tackle, you know, you don't get a lot of, you know, unless you're Aaron Donald, you don't get a lot of glory. Yeah. Your name called a lot. You know, you don't get a lot of tackles or statistics. And so I'm just there to be able to support the guys around me. And the other 10 guys are the reason that I'm able to do what I do. So I was able to make a couple plays on Saturday, but all that credit goes to my teammates and also my coaches putting me in the best possible position to make those plays.
There's a popular quote you hear in football locker rooms, trust the other 10 guys out on the field. Is that something that the coaches kind of reflect on you guys?
Huge. I mean, I think every single day, at least 25 times a day we hear, hey, just do your 111th, yeah. right? That's kind of our thing. Do your 111th. Don't try and do anybody else's job. Don't try and be super fancy with it, right? You want to be special, right? You want to be a playmaker and go out there and have your name called a bunch, right? But if your name isn't called a lot, but you do your job every single time, then guess what? It's gonna show up because other guys are going to make plays, but they're going to know that was because of you. And so it's not about being able to make everybody else's play. Just make your plays and do your job. Do your 111th.
You mentioned you came to Dixie State to do more than just play football. One of those is to go to school. And I met you. You were doing the Andy Thompson Reach and Rush show. You were working the camera. That's when I kind of first met you. And you're a media studies major just like myself.
Yes.
Kind of take me through, how on earth are you balancing football life, school life, and your social life? Max, how do you do it?
You know, it's always difficult, you know, being any kind of athlete and trying to juggle school, not only school, but trying to get good grades as well, right? Because you got to be eligible. You got to meet a certain GPA and a certain requirement in every class to be able to continue to play and be on the field. But, you know, again, if you take it seriously and if it's something that matters to you, you're going to make it happen. You know, and that's what they, you know, whether it's in football, whether it's in school, whether it is in life, everything that you come across, nothing is impossible if you really want to make it happen. And so just trying to juggle all those things. I know that football is very important to me. School is very important to me. You know, the social life is important, but not as important as those two. And so if I'm able to get those two done, then, and the social life comes after that, I'm okay with that because, you know, it's about getting a degree. It's about succeeding on the field. It's about doing what I can to help my teammates and represent Dixie State in the best possible way out in the community. And so just trying to juggle all that, it is very difficult, but, you know, I know that if I want to make it happen, I'm going to make it happen.
A man that has been in the news here over the past couple of weeks that you're very familiar with, Paul Peterson. He got signed, the head coach of Dixie State, an extension through 2025. I work for ESPN Radio in town. We've had him on the Devin Dixon Show the past 2 weeks. I've been in there, sat in there with him. What kind of makes him such a great coach? Why does he deserve this contract through 2025?
You know, a head coach needs to be a great CEO. That's really what he is. You know, he's not in there to step on toes. He's there to hire great coordinators, hire great coaches, be a great coach himself, you know, of course, be a football mind. But also the biggest attribute of a head coach, I believe, is to be able to manage people, you know, not know the X and O's of football, but be able to manage people and human beings. And I think that's Coach Peterson's best quality as a head football coach. And I think that's why he's a great guy for this job. I know that's why he was brought here to Dixie State, was for this transition, was to transition this team and this school and this program into Division One. He had a lot of success at Snow College, you know, doing that and making them a top five team every year in junior college football. And that's the goal that he set for us here at Dixie State. And so just with his mindset, with his attitude, and with what he brings to the table as a coach and a manager of people, I think that's why he's got this extension, and he definitely deserves it.
Another guy from last game. Hadn't seen him pretty much all year, but as soon as he steps onto the field, he pops off your screen. Not only is he like the fastest player on your team, he's for sure the tallest. 6'8", Devin Osborne finally made a return from that hamstring injury. Being on that team, being with the guys every day, what was it like? Were you guys happy for Osborne to come back?
Yes, it was great to see Devin out there, you know, and of course, who doesn't want a 6'8", long, lengthy wide receiver on the outside, right? What quarterback and what team in general, well, you know, wouldn't ask for that? Especially, again, as a defensive guy, we want the offense out on the field as long as possible because that means they're getting points. That means they're driving down. That means they're getting that other defense tired and giving us a little bit of a break. So, yeah, it was great to see Devin back out there, being able to run around a little bit and kind of do what he does. And hopefully, you know, during this last stretch of the season, he can get a little bit more healthy and he can catch some touchdowns for us.
Heck yeah. Let's go back to high school for a quick sec. You showed out in high school football. You dominated that. We know that. But I saw in your bio on Dixie State Athletics, you even played some basketball. You were telling me before we started the show how you were maybe going to play some college basketball. Kind of take me through your basketball career, man.
So basketball was really my first love, and it was probably because up until probably my junior year of high school, I was better at basketball than I was at football.
Wow.
And, you know, I had the fun opportunity. I played AAU basketball for a couple of years for Thurl Bailey, you know, the announcer for the Utah Jazz. And he played for the Jazz for about a decade. And so I was able to play with him, for him, and with his son who played at Marquette. And play, you know, so I played with, you know, I played with Yoli Childs. I played with Brendan Bailey. I played with Connor Harding. I played with a lot of the guys who are now at BYU. And again, Brendan went to Marquette and played. And so I had the chance to play with a lot of really, really good basketball players. And it was a whole bunch of fun and learn from them as well. But at the end of the day, I was a big man. And I was always taller and bigger and more physical than everybody else. And then I stopped growing. You know, I'm only 6'2". And so I kind of looked in the mirror and said, I guess I got to give this football thing a try. And it ended up working out for the best. So, but yeah, basketball was always my first love. And I'm as passionate about basketball as I am for football.
Man, I got to think, if Paul Peterson let you play intramural basketball, would you be doing it? Would you be dunking on kids?
You know, I'd probably play. Yes, I definitely don't have bounce that I did. You know,
I could use you on my team.
Yeah, for sure. You know, I mean, I'm up about 60 pounds from high school. You know, I was a stand-up 5-tech defensive end coming out of high school, and now I'm a 3-tech, you know, defensive tackle, nose tackle type, you know, at 280. And so I have definitely put on the weight, so I can't bounce like I used to, but I definitely go play some intramural basketball just because, again, that's kind of what I do in my pastime and in the summertime is play basketball when I'm not playing football. And it just keeps me in shape as well, you know, having to run up and down the court.
So on the year, I noticed this, you have 10 total tackles, but in that category, the sack category, that is the big one, not quite a sack yet. What would it mean for you to get your first sack here at Dixie?
It would mean a lot. It would be great, again, because in high school I was a pass rusher. You know, my senior year I led 5A in sacks and that was kind of my thing. And so it's definitely been a different transition for me, moving in, you know, gaining more weight, moving inside to the defensive tackle spot and learning how to pass rush from there. But I just got to be better. That's really what it all comes down to is every single day I need to be able to put myself in a position, because my coaches have done a great job of teaching me about technique, helping me learn the game. It's just about me applying it more and me getting better personally outside of practice, outside of meetings, outside of our team film study, being able to do all that on my own. That's what it's really going to take. And so I just know, me personally, I just have to be better, and it will mean a lot when I get a chance to have that first sack.
Speaking of putting on weight, I know that's something I've been trying to do over the last couple of years, not just football players, but a lot of kind of guys in the 18 to 25 range. That's something that we try to do for fitness. What kind of is the approach from the football staff once you show up at Dixie State to gaining that weight that you need to gain? How do you do it?
You eat. you eat and you eat and you eat.
Is there like a specific plan that you follow?
You know, it kind of depends on your position, right? Like, it kind of depends on how much weight they want you to put on.
Yeah.
You know, if you're an offensive or defensive lineman and they just want you to pack on the weight, it's just about eating everything in sight as much as you can, along with lifting weights, right? Because if you just eat and don't lift or work out or exercise, you're just going to get fat. For a skilled guy, for a skilled position, you know, they're going to have you on a more detailed plan of, okay, eat this, don't eat this, kind of cut this, do this. But yeah, for me, it was all about just eating. And I kind of ate myself into a defensive tackle. I remember being at Snow College and they kind of told me that I wasn't, you know, for what they want and what teams want in defensive ends now, I'm kind of a little too short for that. And so they said, hey, your best chance is to put on weight, slide inside, and be a defensive tackle. And I was lucky enough to be successful at that and ended up as a junior college All-American by the time I was done at Snow College. And so it's really just about putting in the time and the want to of eating right, lifting, running. And protein's a big part of that too, right? There's a whole bunch of protein powder and all that stuff you can do. And so, and it's also about doing your own research and deciding what you feel is best for you personally.
Max Christensen here on the Jacob Zimmerman Show on 91.3. We're having a good one here. Max, let's loosen this up a little bit. What is your favorite NFL team?
Okay, so this one hurts me a little bit, and I'm about ready to jump off the bandwagon here. But, you know, so I'm originally from Houston, Texas, right? So I'm a Texans fan. And it has been ugly, like so bad. I mean, ever since the DeAndre Hopkins trade, everything's gone downhill. You know, just 2 years ago, we were sitting, I wasn't personally, but, you know, we were in Arrowhead Stadium up 21-0 on Patrick Mahomes and the Chiefs to go to the AFC Championship game and go play for a Super Bowl, right? And I remember looking at my buddy when we were up 21-0, and I said, hey, if they lose this game, they better fire everyone. Don't get rid of it, because I didn't like Bill O'Brien. Right.
You saw it coming.
Oh, my gosh. I saw it coming. And I said, don't get rid of the team. Keep the team. Right. But fire everyone. And they lost that game. And they said, you know what, Bill O'Brien? We're not only going to keep you as a head coach. We're going to make you the general manager, too. And so and then he goes and gives DeAndre Hopkins away for a second round pick and a bag of chips.
Bag of chips,
and luckily they let. I'm a big J.J. Watt fan. I'm sad he's out for the rest of the year, you know, with a shoulder injury. I've had a couple season-ending shoulder surgeries as well, so I know how that is. But I'm glad they let him walk, because he was wasting his time there those last couple of years in Houston. I'm really sad about Deshaun Watson, but I don't blame him for wanting to leave either.
What I'll say on the Texans, man, it's tough, because he's in the news, and it almost seems like he's going to get traded because of the allegations, regardless of what happens. There's no way he can play in Houston, Texas again. My team is kind of on the slide as well. I'm from North Carolina. I'm a Carolina Panthers fan. Start out the year 3-0. Have the most injury-prone player in the National Football League, Christian McCaffrey. it's tough. I know what you're kind of going through with your teams on the slide. Just a couple years ago, we were there in the mix of maybe winning the Super Bowl, just like you guys. And then the NFL's quick, man. You can be at the top, and you're right back at the bottom in 2 years, and right back at the top again within 2 years as well. So the last question I'll ask you, blank is next after college for Max Christensen.
Sports broadcasting.
That's
the emphasis of my major. That is always been a dream for me, whether it's on the radio. The dream is to be a color commentator for football or basketball, you know, sit on TV, kind of talk about that, or be part of a pregame, postgame thing, you know, run the stats, whatever. But also just being able to sit on the radio, sit on television, just talk about sports, right? Like we're doing right now. And so, you know, I hopefully one day can be in your chair, you know, kind of starting my career, starting off.
He's going to take my job. He's going to take it.
You know, hey, maybe we can co-host a show one day.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
Let's do it.
Right. The Jake and Max show. But yeah, that's really what the goal is for me, is to be able to be behind the microphone, share my opinions, you know, because the biggest thing for a sports broadcaster, you have to have the personality that people want to know what you're talking about, right? People want to know your opinion on stuff. Mm-hmm. And I feel like I have that personality, but the biggest thing is just being able to, you know how it is, getting your foot in the door.
Yeah.
Right. It's all about networking, getting to know people who are in this industry and kind of go from there. But yeah, that's hopefully the next steps for me after Dixie State is starting my sports broadcasting career.
Max Christensen here on 91 Through the Blaze on the Jacob Zimmerman Show. Max, thank you so much for coming on, but take this time to shout out your social media.
Yeah, so I guess my social media, both Twitter and Instagram, is at Maximus Bain. Go follow me. Go check me out. If you follow me, I'll follow you back. And yeah, go Trailblazers. I appreciate the time, man.
No problem, man. Thank you so much for coming on the show. When we come back, we'll have a little Yes or BS NBA edition here on the Jacob Zimmerman Show.
Hi, Sarah. I just spoke with Pamela. Did you know the health care law gives us new Medicare preventive benefits, like a yearly wellness visit?
Well,
it's our chance to talk with our doctor about our care.
That's what I would.
Medicare also covers recommended cancer and preventive screenings.
Actually, I was the one who told Pamela.
Oh.
Uh-huh. Learn more at Medicare.gov or call 1-800-MEDICARE. And tell your friends and family. Share the news. Share the health.
My name is Dale Pazinski, and this is how I live United. I volunteer with United Way, helping the homeless in my community by teaching computer skills and helping them build a basic resume to save on their very own USB drive. It's huge when somebody says, "Hey man, that job that you helped me apply for, I got it." My name is Dale Pazinski. I help people achieve financial independence. So I don't just wear the shirt, I live it.
Give, advocate, volunteer, live United. Go to liveunited.org, brought to you by United Way and the Ad Council.
So, I'm a dog, and I just got adopted by this new human guy, and I'm starting to wonder how he got along without me. I mean, okay, something as simple as walking around the block. He's got this leash thing, and he puts me on one end and him on the other, and I'm just taking him around. I think he's afraid of getting lost. Without that leash and me guiding him along, I don't think he'd find his way back home. But it's kind of cute.
A person is the best thing to happen to a shelter pet. Be that person. Adopt. Brought to you by the Ad Council and the ShelterPetProject.org.
If this radio spot were Nikki Baker's life, it would start pretty normal, like this.
And about this far in, Nikki would drop out of high school.
Here, she'd be forced to work two jobs, but then she'd decide to earn her GED diploma.
It would be the beginning of a brighter future. For free info about GED test prep classes, call 1-877-38-YOUR-GED or visit yourged.org and begin your brighter future.
GED is a registered trademark of the American Council on Education, brought to you by Dollar General Literacy Foundation and the Ad Council.
Ranger Station.
Hi, I want to report a bear sighting.
Location?
My front door. It was Smokey Bear. My husband was burning leaves in the yard. He just came inside for a second.
Never leave a fire unattended. If it's too hot to touch, it's too hot to leave.
Smokey said that too.
We go way back. I knew him when he was just a cub.
How cute.
If you see someone in danger of starting a wildfire, step in and make a difference. Brought to you by Smokey Bear, the U.S. Forest Service, your state forester, and the Ad Council. Learn more at SmokeyBear.com.
Only you can prevent wildfires.
Ranger Station.
Yeah, hi. I'd like to report a bear sighting, as in Smokey Bear. We were about to head home after a bonfire, and Smokey said the fire wasn't actually out. He said if it's too hot to touch, it's too hot to leave.
Did you know that 9 out of 10 wildfires are caused by humans?
No kidding.
I'm a forest ranger. We never kid.
Sorry.
Kidding. If you see someone in danger of starting a wildfire, step in and make a difference. Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service, your state forester, and the Ad Council. Learn more at SmokeyBear.com.
Only you can prevent wildfires.
Ranger Station, Ranger speaking.
Hi, I'd like to report a bear sighting, as in Smokey Bear.
Continue.
I was burning yard waste. He told me to remember that if it's too hot to touch, it's too hot to leave.
You know, 9 out of 10 wildfires are caused by humans. That means 9 out of 10 wildfires can be prevented.
I know that now.
As usual, the talking bear gets all the credit. Always burn responsibly and contact your local fire department for open burning regulations. Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service, your state forester, and the Ag Council. Learn more at SmokeyBear.com.
Only you can prevent wildfires.
Ranger Station.
Yeah, hi. I'd like to report a bear sighting in the forest.
Uh-huh.
One second I'm having a smoke. Next thing I know, I'm face-to-face with Smokey Bear.
Wow.
And he told me it only takes one spark to start a wildfire.
Did you know 9 out of 10 wildfires are caused by humans?
I had no idea.
That's why Smokey's famous and you're not. If you see someone in danger of starting a wildfire, step in and make a difference. Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service, your state forester, and the Ad Council. Learn more at SmokeyBear.com.
Only you can prevent wildfires.
Welcome back to the Jacob Zimmerman Show on 91.3 The Blaze. There was Max Christensen of Dixie State Football. If you want to watch Max this weekend, the call will be right here on 91.3 The Blaze, 11 a.m. for Dixie State Football at Delaware on the East Coast. That's kind of why it's a game in the morning, because of the time change, of course. But the final of Dixie State Volleyball just got done. I'm going to send it down to my good friend and a guy who makes a lot of appearances on this show. He's currently finished up the game right now on ESPN+.
Errors. McKenna Nelson with 11 digs. And then we have Lauren Mina with 10 assists. I'm not sure if that's right. I didn't call her name that much tonight. But it says 10 assists here. But as for Chicago State player of the game, I think this is an absolute no-brainer to anyone who watched this game. 20 kills on the afternoon with 42 total attacks. So they were feeding her, and Nyla Jones as well, with 17 kills in 33 attacks. Now, Jacqueline Inclon, 36 assists here in this game. Most of them, obviously, to Felicin Jones. And Inclon also having 14 digs on the afternoon. So everyone doing a little bit of everything, but Yanlise Felice gets the player of the game. So Dixie State moves to 5-13 on the season, 4-6 in WAC play. And as for Chicago State, they improved to 14-7 and 6-3 in the conference. The next home game for Dixie State, November 11th against Seattle U. So that's, again, another 2 weeks from now. So we got two games in between them, New Mexico State and Grand Canyon. Then we come back to the Burns Arena. That's going to wrap it up here, folks, for James Guerin and everyone else here. We thank you guys for tuning in. This has been a presentation of
Thank you, James Guerin. Send it down to him to give you the final of the Dixie State volleyball game that just happened in the Burns Arena. Chicago State gets the sweep over Dixie State, 3-0 in the volleyball game. Always fun to talk a little bit of Dixie State volleyball, mixing it up with some Lady Trailblazers. I had McKenna Nelson on the volleyball team, the libero, the star libero. She was my first interview here on the Jacob Zimmerman Show, and that was great. Obviously, just had Max Christensen on the show. Boy, was that a great interview. I don't know if I'm going to get those quality of answers from any other athlete. No offense to anybody, but that's Max. I mean, he's going to sports media like myself. He gave some great answers. I can't wait to listen back to that one. James Guerin will be on his way over to the studios here. We will save yes or BS for when he gets here, but right now, let's kind of go over some week 8 spreads in the NFL. It's time, obviously, week 8 got started just a few hours ago with the Packers and Cardinals. The Packers are up 10-7 in Arizona. But for the rest of the games that have not happened, let's get into these point spreads. If you like to go down to Mesquite from time to time like I do, that is where you can bet on these games. Of course, sports betting, gambling, not legal in the state of Utah, so don't try to do it. Go to a legal state, but the Panthers, Falcons, Atlanta -3 is the spread, and this one hurts. The Panthers fan, pretty much in every game this year, have been, how could you put this spread against the Panthers? And every week, I'm proved wrong. It was -3 Panthers last week against the Giants. We lost 25-3. That was an ugly one. If I picked the Panthers +3, I would be a fool. Atlanta -3, you got to take them. Bills and Dolphins, this is a -14 spread. I'm going to say the Dolphins cover. I think they have enough in the tank. I think the Bills are kind of trying to coast, not relax, but just get all their guys as healthy as possible for a great postseason run. Maybe rounded in shape here in the last couple of regular season games. But against the Dolphins, only 14, I think the Dolphins can cover. 49ers, Bears. The Bears are at 3-4. This game will be at San Francisco. No, I think it's at Chicago, actually. Not quite sure on that one. 49ers, 2-4. Not really off to the start that I thought they were going to be off to. A lot of people thought they were going to be off to. And the Bears, so far, kind of looking like that middle-of-the-pack team they've been over the past several seasons. -4.5 for San Francisco is the spread. I'm going to say you take that. I think they'll win by at least 4. When these spreads are really close and you favor one team over the other, I think it's safe to take it. Moving on to the Steelers and the Browns. Steelers are at 3-3. The Browns are at 4-3. This one will be on CBS 11 a.m. Cleveland -3.5. Now, Cleveland at home, they typically give about 3 points to the home team. I think this is actually going to go in favor of the Steelers. I would take the Steelers +3.5. I think their defense is a lot better. Who knows if Baker will play? It's probably going to be Case Keenum yet again. I think with that slight downgrade and really not a lot of help right now in the rest of the roster, OBJ's not giving me anything fantasy-wise. I think the Steelers will cover. Steelers +3.5. Lions, Eagles, the Lions are 0-7. I'm just going to take the Eagles, -3.5. Colts and Titans, this one on CBS as well, 11 a.m. Colts -2.5. It is at home against the Titans, and the Titans have been a dominant team of recent. Even though the Colts have kind of started to turn the tide of their season, Carson Wentz coming on strong here in the past couple of weeks, the Colts are the Colts, and the Titans are the Titans with Derrick Henry, who's going to run for at least 2,000 yards yet again this season. Back-to-back 2K. Can you say it again? The Titans will win this one and take the spread +2.5. For the Bengals and the Jets, this one, an interesting one. Cincinnati -10.5. The Jets got absolutely smacked last week by the Patriots, of course. They haven't beat the Patriots in like 7 years. But the Jets are at home. Will it make a difference? I'm going to say no. I'm rolling with Cincy minus 10.5. Texans and Rams. Just had Max Christensen tell me the Texans were his favorite team, and it's unfortunate because I got to do it to him. The Rams, I'm taking them. -14.5. That's a huge spread, but the Texans are the Texans. Sorry, Max. Patriots, Chargers. This one, kind of a close spread with the Patriots coming off that huge win over the Jets. It is the Jets, but they dominated. Facing the Chargers now at 4-2. It's -4.5 for them at home. I'm going to take it. I say the Chargers win. Justin Herbert shows out. They win by at least 4.5. I'll run through these next couple pretty quick. Jaguars, Seahawks. I'll take Seahawks -3.5. The fact that that spread is that close is concerning. Broncos, Washington, -3 for Denver. I'm going to say Washington covers in that. Buccaneers, Saints. It's Bucks -4.5. It is in New Orleans. I'm going to say Tampa Bay, whatever you want to call it, goes in there and stomps up NO Town. I'm taking Tampa Bay -4.5. Then, Sunday Night Football, 6:20. Cowboys, Vikings, -2.5 for the Vikings. It's another tough one, but I'm going to say if Dak Prescott plays, they will win. But I'm thinking this spread right now is assuming he doesn't play. If he doesn't play, Vikings -2.5 for sure. And then rounding it out, Monday Night Football, Giants, Chiefs. It's KC -9.5, but they've been struggling recently, and the Giants got a big win last week. I'm going to say Giants cover +9.5. So little spreads here on the Jacob Zimmerman Show. We'll take a quick break, and when we come back, we will have the NBA Yes or BS.
Are you facing foreclosure? Then come down to Megalo and Partners. We're a mortgage rescue company, and we can help you keep your house. Provided you submit to our plans for galactic domination. No, no, I'm kidding.
If you're facing foreclosure, talk to the right people. Speak with HUD-approved housing counselors free of charge at 888-995-HOPE. Brought to you by NeighborWorks America and the Ad Council.
I'm in almost every school bus and classroom. You see me around the neighborhood, and you tell me that I'm a pretty good kid.
Well, I'm one out of every 5 children in America, and I'm struggling with hunger.
Please visit feedingamerica.org today and find your local food bank for ways to help.
Every dollar you donate helps provide 8 meals for kids like me.
We are Feeding America, brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council.
Hi, I'm Dustin Lynch. You don't have to listen to country music to know that life can be full of drama. Some of it you just can't control, like your girlfriend running out on you with your best friend. But there's some drama you can skip.
Skip the drama that comes with not having your high school diploma or equivalency. Find free adult education classes near you and finish your diploma. Visit finishyourdiploma.org. That's finishyourdiploma.org.
You just need to take that first step and find free classes near you and start moving towards a brighter future and even your college degree.
Brought to you by the Dollar General Literacy Foundation and the Yet Council.
Hi, I'm Matt Kenseth. You don't have to be a race car driver to know that life can be full of drama. Some of it you can't control, like mechanical issues, high winds, and rain delays. But there's some drama you can skip.
Skip the drama that comes with not having your high school diploma or equivalency. Find free adult education classes near you and finish your diploma. Visit finishyourdiploma.org. That's finishyourdiploma.org.
You just need to take that first step and find free classes near you and leave the drama for the racetrack.
Brought to you by the Dollar General Literacy Foundation and the Ed Council.
Welcome back to the Jacob Zimmerman Show on 91.3 The Blaze. Back after some fallout, boy. What's going on? 91.3 St. George, Utah. Southern Utah, wherever you're listening to the Jacob Zimmerman Show. Thank you for listening. But back to the segment that I've been wanting to do here for a little bit. Had it last week with Price and James, expecting James to bust through that door any second and help me out with these. But I'll go ahead and start these off myself. I like to do some NBA yes or BS. It's a statement. I've seen it around the sports world or deep in the depths of those dangerous Instagram, Twitter, whatever social media you follow that provides NBA content, comment sections, And I tell you, if that opinion is a yes, I agree, or BS bull crap, no, that is not facts at all. Let's dive right into this. All these are NBA questions, talking recent NBA topics. Last night, the Lakers choked a huge one, but at the very end, Carmelo Anthony, Malik Monk airballed game-tying shots. This is concerning for Lakers fans. Well, I'll start this one off right now. I'm putting my feet up on the desk. I'm not concerned at all. BS, it's not concerning. Here's what I'll say. LeBron James did not play. LaMelo Carmelo, I'm going to mess these up all year long. Carmelo Anthony had a really hot start to the year. He kind of came back down to earth really hard and had a really bad game last night. Malik Monk had also had a pretty good start to the year and had an air ball late in the game to tie it. Both Melo and Malik had a chance to tie it. But I'm going to say it's not concerning. You know, without LeBron, it's a totally different team. And these guys are going to round into shape when it's playoff time. It's too early to have a serious takeaway with the Lakers right now. Evan Mobley will win Rookie of the Year. I'm going to say another BS on this. I think it's going to go to an offensive player. But the point is of having this is to kind of rave about Evan Mobley. I think he's going to be really good. He can defend any position out there on the court. Not only is he tall, he's lengthy, he can jump, he can really be a defensive nightmare against any team. And he's already getting a lot of blocks that really aren't common blocks. I don't really know how to put that, but if you watch the highlights, you'll know what I'm talking about. I'm going to say BS will go to an offensive player, someone like that, but Evan Mobley will be a huge factor in the NBA for years to come. Steph Curry will break his own three-pointers made record per game in a single season. He had 5.2 last year. That was actually more than his 5.1 that I remember off the top of my head from his 2016 season. And I think he doesn't. I think he averages maybe 5.3 this year. Because Steph Curry is insane. And year after year, he improves. They're going to give this guy more and more attempts every year. There's a couple weeks until we still see Klay come back. For Steph Curry to break his own three-pointers made record, which he set last year for per game at 5.2. James Guerin, you just came over from the volleyball game. We heard the end of your call, but we're doing some yes or BS here, and the topic is Steph Curry will break his own three-pointers made record per game in a single season. He has it at 5.2.
What'd you say?
I said yes.
That's BS.
Really?
That's BS all over it. What happened when he set the record? They missed the playoffs, dude. Missed the playoffs.
Oh, my gosh. You think Steph Curry's not going to have 5.3 three-pointers made per game this year?
If he does, the team's not going to be very good. What does that mean? It just means he's hogging the ball and he's taking way more shots than everybody else does. And granted, they have to do that because
you can take as many shots as you want when you're shooting 45% from three, James.
No, that's fair. That's fair. And they're 4-0 right now. Do they play tonight? Is that pending tonight?
Yeah, they play tonight.
You know, they're the only other team besides the 84-85 Sixers to be losing at halftime in all four games and to win all of them.
What a stat.
Yeah, ESPN,
are you
baby.
ESPN?
I saw it on ESPN.
Of course.
And they finished 32-45 that year. So not very good historically.
Next up on NBA Yes or BS, here with James Guerin joining the show. John Collins is the best in-game dunker in the NBA.
I know exactly what you're referring to.
all the massive monster posters. I can't believe.
Was it on Kelly Olynyk, one you and I saw? Yes. That was just unreal?
I think I know what you're going to say, but I can't believe I'm going to say BS. It's so close with these two guys, but I got to give it to Miles Bridges. Just a small bit over him. If you look at his
smaller,
look at his dunk over Clint Capella last year.
I didn't see that.
You haven't seen
that?
No,
but off the air, we'll watch it, and you might change my mind.
Clint Capella was top three last year in Defensive Player of the Year. Miles Bridges went all the way up in the air, cocked all the way back, and threw it down.
Maybe I did see it. I just don't remember it.
You totally
I definitely
saw it.
Probably saw it.
Anyway, John Collins is a top two dunker in the league, regardless of what you think. He is. James Harden
He's getting exposed by the rule chains. Yes!
Yes, 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 yes. And it's about time.
It's about...
it's about
oh,
time.
Oh, man. We've been waiting for years. I remember watching James Harden play Golden State and just screaming at my laptop because every time down the court, James Harden is not trying to score a basketball. He's trying to get a foul.
Yeah.
That's what he's trying to do.
Well, when he averaged, 36 that one year? How many of those were free throws? How many free throws did he average?
He averaged 11 free throw attempts per game,
11
years ago.
Was that when he won? Is that when he averaged 36 points per game? That's when he won MVP.
All of those seasons in Houston, he was at least 10 3-point attempts per game.
Free throw. Okay.
3-point attempts also were high.
Well, that's the D Wade rule. Because remember, D Wade was the one that kind of started that whole thing, kind of pump faking, waiting for the defender to jump at you and then leaning into it. Harden does that a lot too. But
the main thing is when he's driving to the basket and he just hooks the defender's arm and then just jumps into the air, the defender cannot do anything about that.
I think it actually makes it a little bit more effective because he's a lefty. So everything is backwards.
And I think that's why he caught everybody off guard and he was able to do it.
Well, if you look at it, he always drives in from the left side. That's where he gets most of his fouls. So no, it says yes. This is a yes all the way.
Oh, yeah. Solid 100%. I got one for you, James. It's a Jazz question.
Oh, yes. Drum roll.
Bojan Bogdanović can average 20 points per game in the playoffs for the Jazz.
He can do it
in the regular season.
What did he average last year?
He averaged about 18.
18? Honestly, I'm a Pacer... kind of a fan. They're my second team, so I watched Bojan a lot when he was in Indiana. He was better when he was in Indiana. I'm sorry. Oh yeah. Because the system that the Jazz work or the system that the Jazz do, it's not friendly to slow, unathletic forwards. I'm sorry, but it's not
Joe Ingles?
He's a slow forward, dude.
Yeah.
Come on. He's slow.
But he's having success.
He's having sure he was second in sixth man of the year, but
behind Jordan,
you're averaging 14 points a game. I'm supposed to think that's unworldly? No.
Point is, with the Jazz, they're going to need someone like Bojan or Clarkson or
I'm actually more of a believer in Clarkson averaging more than Bojan.
In the playoffs?
Absolutely. Because
he can get it himself.
Well, he can drive. I mean, he's shown situations where he can shoot if he absolutely needs to, but... Speaking of dunkers, I mean, you don't remember him on the Lakers, dude? How many times he threw it down on people, and then people just kind of forgot about him. Where did he go? He went to Cleveland.
He went to the tattoo parlor.
He went to Cleveland, and then everyone kind of forgot about him. And then he went to the Jazz, kind of made a name for himself again, won Sixth Man of the Year. So I would even be Jordan Clarkson's probably the third best player on that team.
So it's a BS from me and James. I got two more for you. Nope, one more. Ja Morant will earn all NBA honors this season.
Ooh, that's actually super tough. I would say no as of right now.
So BS, I'm going to go.
I wish I could explain it. But
if he has the same stats as someone like Damian Lillard, it's going to go with Lillard over him because of the bigger name. But he might have stats worthy of
All NBA are people that actually have credibility to their name. It's not fans like you and me that can vote for it, which is why I still think the All-Star is a hoax.
That is going to do it for the Jacob Zimmerman Show here today on a Thursday night. Every Thursday night at 7 through 8. No music. Mark your calendars. It's the Jacob Zimmerman Show. We talk Thursday night football. We talk some NBA yes or BS. I talked a little bit about the spreads. And I had the big interview with Max Christensen, who absolutely nailed it. Go follow Max on Instagram and as well as Dixie State Football on Instagram. I'll have the call for you here 11 a.m. Saturday here on 91.3. This has been the Jacob Zimmerman Show. Have a good night, everybody. Stay sporty.